Hello everyone, this is Dr. Savita Nandi speaking on the engineering chemistry syllabus. Today I am discussing on the last topic of module 3, that is solar cells. Now, in the module 3, we have discussed on various other topics, and all those topics are included in the video in the YouTube channel My Intuition. Kindly you can refer to anything which is required. Okay. So now in this video I shall be discussing on the solar cells. Okay, they are photovoltaic cells, so their advantages, limitations, so their constructions, and the synthesis of the solar grade silicon. So now, what are photovoltaic cells? Now we all have heard about photovoltaic cells. Photovoltaic cells. These are semiconductor devices that convert the solar energy into direct current electricity. These devices are called as photovoltaic cells, and simply they are also called as solar cells. So the solar cells are mainly dependent on silicon, that is the semiconductor material. As you all know, the silicon has is a tetravalent. It has four valence electrons. So now when it is exposed to sunlight, what happens is one of the electrons gets excited. Okay, this excited electron, when it gets excited, there also a hole is created. Okay, so this electron hole pair, the production of electron hole pair is mainly responsible for the generation of electricity. So, and this photovoltaic cell is mainly based on photoelectric effect. That means when the light falls on a semiconductor, electron jumps from the conduction band to the valence band. In the valence band, the holes are created, and this electron hole pair they can move. Okay, so that is responsible for the generation of electricity, right? Now, the photovoltaic cell performs two functions. One is the photo generation of charges. That you see, when sunlight falls, the electron jumps and gets excited from conduction valence band to conduction band, and there will be a positive charge and a hole, the minority charge carrier, and the electron. Okay, so this photo generation of charge carriers is the first function of the photovoltaic cell, and that can be done only by exposing to sunlight. Okay, and the second one is separation of the charges. Okay, separation of the charges means the electron should not come back to its original state there only. It should travel through an external circuit and then come to the get neutralized. Okay, so and this separation of charges can be only done by a potential gradient, that is a p-n junction, by creating a p-n junction. Okay, so that means the two functions are photo generation and the separation of charges. Okay, so now let us discuss on construction and working of photovoltaic cells. Right, now there is n-type. See, there is a silicon. The silicon, as you know, it is tetravalent. In an n-type semiconductor, see, it is doped with the phosphorus, that is pentavalent impurity. See, it here it is shown the extra electron. Okay, so here and here there is an extra electron shown, which is pentavalent. Otherwise, silicon is tetravalent. Okay, so this is n-type semiconductor. Similarly, the p-type semiconductor is done by taking silicon, which is doped with the trivalent impurities. Okay, so this trivalent impurity is shown by a hole here. See, you can see a hole here. Okay, that means it is trivalent. So the n-type and the p-type semiconductors are brought together. That means they are made into combined with one another. Okay, so then what happens is you there is a p-n junction, right? In the p-n junction, we can see the p-n junction in the middle, right? Now, due to the presence of the p-n junction, there will be a depletion region, right? Okay, so I'm just showing you the n-type, which is having the extra electrons, and the p-type, which is having the holes and the p-n junction. Okay, so it is covered with the anti-reflective layer because n-type is exposed to sunlight. To utilize the maximum sunlight, it is covered with the anti-reflective layer. Okay, there are grids. These are current conductors. And these metallic grids, it is not continuous because it should allow the sunlight to pass through. Okay, whereas at the P side, that is the downside, it is completely covered by a metal grid, right? Because here there is no need to be get exposed. That's why it is continuous. Okay, and these metallic layers are the current collectors, and these are connected externally. And if there is an, it is connected through an application. So when the sunlight flows, the electrons are connected by the upper n-type current collectors, it is electron collectors, and the holes are collected by the p-type current collectors, and they pass through, the current pass through, and we get the sunlight, I mean, we get the electricity. That is, we can use it in the application. Right? Now, the explanation of this is, so the silicon photovoltaic cell is contained of a thin wafer of which contains phosphorus doped silicon, that is n-type silicon, which is kept above the other, that is the silicon which is doped with the p-type, okay, boron is doped. And this p-n junction is formed between the two layers, which is also called the depletion region. The n-type end is connected to the metallic grid, and the p-type is connected to the metallic sheet, continuous sheet. These two ends are connected to the storage device, which can be used for applications. So the anti-reflective layer containing silicon, silicon nitride, increases the amount of light transmitted to the semiconductor because it will avoid the reflection. Okay? The current output and hence the efficiency of the solar cell is proportional to the intensity of the light striking on the surface of the cell. Okay? Therefore, the solar cells are connected electrically in series or in parallel. To produce the higher current, because if they are connected in series, you can increase the amount of electricity that is generated. Right now. The module, a number of solar cells connected in series and is mounted on a support structure is called a module, right? So it is a cell. This a single unit is a cell, right? Now a module is designed in such a way that it generates a certain voltage, such as common module is of common is 12 volts. Okay, so in a module there are 12 such as cells which are connected in series. Okay, so this is a module. Okay, now this is called a panel. See, there are three modules. A number of modules are connected in series to form a panel. Right, now this panel, that if there are, see, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 panels. This is called an array. Okay, they are connected in parallel to form an array. A photovoltaic array is a complete power generation system. Okay. Next, so you can see some pictures. This is an array, right? So one single, this one is a panel, okay? And one single unit of that is a module. And in the module, there are many cells, okay? And these semiconductors have the capacity to absorb light, and a part of the energy is absorbed of the absorbed photons is used for, by the charge carriers, create the charges, that is electrons and the holes. Okay? The semiconductor diode, that is the PN junction, separates and collects the charge carriers, and it conducts the generated electricity in a specific direction. Okay? And when the light falls on the semiconductor, electrons move towards the N-type, that is current collector, and the holes move towards the P-type, that is the charge collectors at the P-side. Okay? The current flows through the external circuit for the application. Now, what are the advantages and limitations of PV cells? That is photovoltaic cell. The main advantage is they provide a suitable energy system. As long as light is present, the solar cell will generate electricity. And we all know that the solar cell is a renewable source of energy and it is unlimited. Then, when the light falls on the semiconductor, electron move towards P-type, N-type, and holes migrate towards P-type, and the electricity is generated. And it is not required, we need not recharge the PV cells. And it is having a very long lifetime. Okay? PV cells generally don't produce any harmful emissions, and also it will not add up to the pollution. By using the photovoltaic cell, we can also control the global warming. It can be completely avoided. Mm-hmm. Right? Even in remote areas also, where wiring and transmission is not possible, we can provide electricity by using PV cells. They also provide power for spacecrafts and satellites. Right? And this modules, panels, and arrays installation is very quick, and their safety record is very excellent. Because there is no accidents reported due to the PV cell, photovoltaic cell accidents is not yet reported. Okay. Next, what are the limitations? The main limitation is sunlight is a diffused source, and we know that photovoltaic cell generates electricity only when there is sunlight. That's one of the main limitations. Right? Now, PV cell modules and panels and arrays, all these easy installation, but installation cost is high. Okay. Now, to produce a photovoltaic cell, we need silicon. Okay. Now, silicon is one of the elements which is available in the earth's crust. Now, if you see the grades of silicon, there are three grades of silicon. Mainly, two grades are there. First one is metallurgical grade silicon. Okay, now this metallurgical grade silicon, it has certain impurities, like desired impurities, they are called boron and phosphorus. This is what we require, right? Along with this desired impurities, there are certain killer impurities also, right? Now this killer impurities will decrease the lifespan of the minority carriers. And moreover, the purity level of metallurgical grade silicon is not sufficient for the solar cell application. The other grade is semiconductor grade silicon. Now, semiconductor grade silicon, it is very pure. It does not have any impurity. But so much level of purity is not required for solar cell application. And also, since it is very pure, it is very costly also. Right, so availability is also very less. Therefore, and third grade of silicon, that is called the solar grade silicon, is used for solar cell applications. Okay, solar grade silicon. Okay, now this solar grade silicon has impurities, but it has only desired impurities. Okay, it does not have the killer impurities. It is less pure than the semiconductor grade, but it is more pure than the metallurgical grade silicon. Now, how to synthesize this solar grade silicon? Now, solar grade silicon, it is synthesized by the method called union carbide method. Okay, now union carbide method, it has four steps. The first step, it is a reactor, which is called fluidized bed reactor, wherein See, this is metallurgical grade silicon is made to react with tetrachlorosilane. Okay, tetrachlorosilane acts the metallurgical grade silicon and hydrogen. The mixture of all three is fed into a fluidized reactor where it reacts to produce trichlorosilane. Okay, so the first step is production of trichlorosilane. See, there are four chloride atoms. One of the chloride is replaced by hydrogen. You are also feeding it with the hydrogen. This is trichlorosilane. Now, this trichlorosilane is produced, and a byproduct is also produced, that is tetrachlor. Some unreacted also will be there, that will be again recycled back for the second stage. But this trichlorosilane is fed into another chamber fixed by this is a quaternary ammonium ion exchange resins. What is the function of this is, when you pass this trichlorosilane through this chamber, okay, another one chloride gets replaced by hydrogen, right? See, there were three chloride atoms. Now, another one is replaced by hydrogen. Okay, that is dichlorosilane. See, production of dichlorosilane is a second step. Okay, along with that, again, unreacted silicon tetrachlorosilane will be produced. That is again sent to the first chamber, where it can be converted into trichlorosilane. Now, this dichlorosilane from the second quaternary ammonium ion exchange resin is taken to another one fixed bed column, like the same quaternary ammonium ion exchange resin, where this dichlorosilane, in this, all the chlorine will be getting replaced by hydrogen. Now, this becomes silane. See, production of silane is the third step in indium carbide method. Now, along with this silane, some trichlorosilane is also produced, and that is, it is an input for the second chamber. So, this can be again sent to the second chamber. Okay, now this silane with SiH4, now the next work is we have to remove the hydrogen. For that, it has to undergo pyrolysis. In the pyrolysis, what is done is the silane is subjected to very high temperature, where there is a silicon rod also. Now, this silane gets splits into silicon and hydrogen. Now, this silicon is solar grade silicon only, and the hydrogen which is produced, it is a hydrogen gas. And this can be again recycled to the first chamber, because first chamber, it also requires hydrogen. Okay, therefore pyrolysis is the last step. You can say production of trichlorosilane, production of dichlorosilane, production of silane, and pyrolysis. These are the four steps involved in the union carbide method. Okay? So the same explanation, hydrogenation, that is the production of trichlorosilane, metallurgical grade silicon, and tetrachlorosilane are treated with the hydrogen in a fluidized bed reactor to get trichlorosilane, and the second the reaction is this, and the second one is production of dichlorosilane in trichlorosilane, which is produced in the first chamber, is exchanged in a quaternary ammonium ion exchange resin to dichlorosilane. Along with that, some tetrachlorosilane is also produced, that will be again recycled to the first chamber. And the third step is production of silane. Here, dichlorosilane is again exchanged with the quaternary ammonium ion exchange resin to form silane. Along with that, trichlorosilane is produced as a byproduct, which is again sent to the second chamber. Okay, and the last step is pyrolysis to get to the final solar grade silane. Okay, that means hydrogen is separated from silicon. Right, now this is the solar grade silicon. Right, now combining hydrogenation, see, you are adding hydrogen to tetrachlorosilane that is hydrogenation, production of dichloroethylene. See, there were 3 chlorine, now 2 chlorine is produced. All right, now that is the second step, production of silane, and that is produced SiH4. Dichloroethylene will again, all the two remaining two chlorides will be replaced by hydrogen. Okay, so you get silane. Later, this silane will be broken to silicon and hydrogen. Okay, in each of this step, there will be byproducts of the previous, previous step reactor, what reactant will be the product of the next reaction. See, here in this step, tetrachloroethylene is produced, which is a react, which is a reactant or a feed-in for the first step. So you, this has to go to the first step. Here, see, trichloroethylene is a product, byproduct. This byproduct is actually the input of the second reaction. So from this byproduct, it is directly fed into the second chamber. Okay, now this one hydrogen is a requirement of the reactant for the first reaction. Therefore, first step. Therefore, from here, all the hydrogen is directly connected to the first chamber. Okay, so like this, the solar grade silicon is synthesized. Right, now this part I have already finished. Almost all topics has been uploaded. Now, thank you for watching this. Thank you.